What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Throughout the series, we've tackled multiple LeetCode problems and attempted to explain most of the concepts and approaches needed to solve them. In addition to this, we covered behavioral interview questions and mentioned that nailing an interview isn't only about writing optimal code. Now, on top of these two big topics, solving problems optimally and answering behavioral questions, we have a third one, and it is system design. What is that, and why do interviewers ask such questions? You see, system design questions refer to interview questions that assess a candidate's ability to architect complex software systems or components. These questions are typically open-ended and require candidates to think critically, analyze requirements, and propose an appropriate design to solve a given problem. They go beyond coding skills and focus on evaluating a candidate's ability to design scalable, efficient, testable, and maintainable systems. The questions often require candidates to consider factors like performance, scalability, reliability, security, data storage, communication protocols, APIs, and other relevant aspects, which we will dive into during this and upcoming videos. System design questions give interviewers a chance to evaluate the candidate's knowledge of system architecture principles, industry best practices, and the ability to make informed design choices based on trade-offs and constraints. These questions provide insights into how candidates approach and solve complex real-world engineering challenges. Preparing for software design interviews is a long journey, and the first step is to learn the concepts or at least have a basic level of knowledge that allows us to speak intelligently about system architecture, meaning you should have a basic idea on what databases are, what are the different types of databases, and how we can benefit from each. You should know what proxies are, what caching is. You should be able to differentiate between horizontal and vertical scaling. You should know the difference between latency, throughput, and availability, and many other design building blocks. Now, obviously, we won't be able to fit all these concepts and principles in the first video, so what we're going to do instead is go over the most important ones in the first couple videos, and throughout the rest of the series, when we find the need to make use of a new concept, we will cover it on the spot. Okay, I'm going to kick it off with scaling. You see, scalability describes a system's elasticity and refers to a system's ability to grow. If we are running a website, web service, or application, its success hinges on the amount of network traffic it receives, and it is common to underestimate just how much traffic your system will incur, especially in the early stages. Thus, scalability describes our system's ability to adapt to change and demand. Good scalability protects you from future downtime and ensures the quality of your service. But what options do we have when it comes to implementing it? That's where horizontal and vertical scaling comes in. When scaling is mentioned, whether for databases, clusters, or servers, it will fall under one of these two categories. Vertical scaling, aka scaling up or down, describes adding additional resources to a system so that it meets demands, while horizontal scaling, aka scaling in or out, refers to an increase or decrease of the number of nodes in a cluster or system to handle an increase or decrease in workload. You see, vertical scaling describes adding more power to your current machines. For instance, if your server requires more processing power, vertical scaling will mean upgrading the CPUs currently in use, whereas horizontal scaling represents adding more nodes having the same size of the currently present ones. Horizontal scaling distributes multiple jobs across multiple machines over the network. This reduces the workload on each machine. However, vertical scaling relies on multi-threading on the existing machine to handle multiple requests at the same time. Let's dive into the advantages and disadvantages of each. Scaling horizontally is easier from a hardware perspective, as all we need to do is add additional machines to our current pool. It eliminates the need to analyze which system specifications we need to upgrade. And because we're adding machines, we don't have to switch the old machine off while scaling, which means that there may never be a need for downtime and clients are less likely to be impacted. Relying on a single node for all our data and operations puts us at a high risk of losing it all when it fails. Distributing it among several nodes saves us from losing it all, increasing the resilience and fault tolerance of our systems. On top of that, the overall performance will increase, as horizontal scaling allows for more endpoints, for more connections that delegate the load among multiple machines. However, everything we just discussed will increase the complexity of our system. Multiple servers are harder to maintain than a single server and harder to back up. Additionally, we will need to add software for load balancing and possibly virtualization. We will discuss these, don't worry about it. Also, adding new servers is far more expensive than upgrading old ones. Now, because of that, vertical scaling is deemed cost-effective. Upgrading a pre-existing server costs less than purchasing a new one. On top of that, you are less likely to add new backups and virtualization software when scaling vertically, so maintenance costs may potentially remain the same too. And not only is maintenance cheaper, but it is less complex because of the number of nodes we need to manage. You are less likely to change the software or an implementation on a server that works. Small parenthesis here, since we mentioned this a couple of times. Virtualization softwares allow a single host computer to create and run one or more virtual environments. It is often used to emulate a complete computer system. Now, back to vertical scaling. One of its main advantages is less complex process communication. When a single node handles all the layers of our services, it will not have to synchronize and communicate with other machines to work. This may result in faster responses. However, relying on a single centralized point of contact will increase the possibility for downtime. You see, unless we have a backup server that can handle operations and requests, we will need some considerable downtime to upgrade our machine. Also, single point of contact means single point of failure. Having all the operations done by a single server increases the risk of losing all the data if a hardware or software failure was to occur. Additionally, this machine we are relying on will certainly have its limitations. Every machine has its threshold for RAM, storage, and processing power. Okay, the next topic I want to tackle is one we mentioned a few minutes ago when we were covering horizontal scaling, and it is load balancing. Load balancing is the method of distributing network traffic equally across a pool of resources that support an application. And that is why there can be no horizontal scaling without load balancing, as spinning up multiple instances of a server is not possible without a load balancer directing traffic efficiently to the cluster. Now, on top of enabling horizontal scaling, load balancing is abstract. The end user only needs to know the address of the load balancer, not the address of every server in the cluster. As soon as the balancer receives a request, it will direct it to the corresponding server and retrieve the result back for us. By distributing load over a cluster, no server becomes a single point of failure, making service availability and response time unaffected by overall traffic. Also, it allows us to roll out software updates without taking the whole service down, by using the load balancer to take out one machine at a time. There are many types of load balancers and many algorithms that can be used by each, such as random round robin, weighted round robin, least load, etc., and the choice of an algorithm is mainly based on the request size, request volume, and server size. In an interview, you most likely will not have to dive this much into detail, so we will cover these on a need basis in the future. Stay tuned for the next video of the series in which we cover additional basic concepts before jumping into architecture and design interview questions. So that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.